Heartiest greetings of joy in Jesus Christ from the Labyrinth here on our Houghton campus. We are so glad that you're here today worshiping with us here at Desert Skies. We're a joyful community drawing people to Christ. I'm Reverend Candace.
And I'm Reverend Susan. And we are here greeting you at the center of the Labyrinth, remembering that Lent is a time of reflection and introspection and reorienting ourselves toward the holy. If you're worshiping with us for the first time, we especially welcome you. We're so glad that you found us online.
We have just a couple of housekeeping things. We have a connection card that we hope you will fill out. The tab to that is at the top right-hand side of your screen. Let us know of your presence. There's also a space there where you can do prayer requests and request more information. We have a Facebook page, a website, all sorts of ways of finding out who we are as a faith community. In your notes section, there is a bulletin. So if you'd like to follow along with an order of worship, we encourage you to do that as well. As always, we invite you to Christ Cafe after our worship. We are just so glad you've joined us today.
And now we invite you to take a deep breath as we enter this time of worship. It's a time centered in the Lenten practice of prayer and of searching the passionate path of Christ as told to us in the Gospel of Mark. Thank you. The story we reflect on today is unique in the New Testament because the healing happens in two stages. And Mark's account also offers a unique symbolic significance as well. Clarity about Jesus' mission comes only after confusion. Right after the story of Jesus healing a man who was blind, Mark shares Peter's great confession of Jesus as the Christ, the Anointed One in Greek, and the equivalent of Messiah in the Hebrew. And that's followed immediately by Peter's confused effort to correct Jesus as he is trying to explain what it is meant to be the Christ. Now it is Peter who is only glimpsing the truth in a fuzzy image, like the trees walking around. Peter couldn't yet grasp that Jesus truly meant that his mission would involve rejection, suffering, and ultimately execution. As we begin to take in what this means for us today, we pray for strength for our Lenten journey. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy.
We are called to follow Jesus, but following Jesus isn't easy. No, it will demand our dedication and our energy. It will change our whole lives. Come, all of you, come and learn of the Lord Jesus. Lord, we come seeking your wisdom and your guidance. Amen. Come this day to hear your words of healing, love, and hope. Enter our hearts and our spirits and teach us to follow you. Give us courage and strength to be your faithful disciples. Amen.
Children, gather around wherever you are. This is our time to talk together during worship. I'm so glad that you're here. I'm just wondering today if you have something like this at your house, a jar or a cup or a basket or a pouch where you keep all of the different things that you can write with. I've got in here some markers, and I've got some mechanical pencils, and I've got a dry erase marker. But one of my favorites is this one right here. It's pink and brown, and it has the word imagine written on it. But it's never been sharpened. So as great a pencil as it is, I can't use it to do what it's made to do because I've never sharpened it. I've never actually picked it up and tried to write with it. There are a lot of things that we can do with a pencil, right? We can, well, you tell me, look at the persons around you and share, what can you do with a pencil? Maybe you thought about writing out your math problems or making a list of important things to do, drawing a beautiful picture, or writing a note to someone you love. But pencils aren't any good for those kinds of things that they're made to do unless we actually use them. So that made me think about our story today and the lessons that Jesus taught his disciples. He taught them that they each had gifts and abilities that were given to them for making the world a better place. But they couldn't do that unless they actually picked up their gifts, practiced their abilities, and used them in the world. Did you know that each one of you also has at least one special gift or ability that God has given you to use to serve others and to make this world a better place? But just like Jesus taught his disciples, sometimes we have to be really brave to try out those things and maybe make a mistake, maybe mess up a time or two. And we also have to practice those things and give them with an attitude of generosity, because the gifts that God gives us to share are for everyone, not just the people that we like. And the best thing of all about what Jesus taught his disciples and teaches us today is that Jesus is always with us when we're practicing, when we're exploring, when we're messing up, and when we're doing great. God never leaves us and is always there beside us to help us along the way. Will you pray with me now, and let's give thanks for those gifts and ask God to help us. Gracious God, we're thankful that you give each one of us something that we're really good at, that we can share with the world. Help us to be brave and to be generous as we learn and grow and share those things as you would have us to do. Thank you that Jesus is always with us to help us along the way. Amen.
Hear these words from the Gospel of Mark. Jesus and his disciples went into the village near Caesarea Philippi. On the way, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that I am?" They told him, "Some say John the Baptist, others Elijah, and still others, one of the prophets." He asked them, "And what about you? Who do you say that I am?" Peter answered, "You are the Christ." Jesus ordered them not to tell anyone about him. Then Jesus began to teach his disciples. The human one must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders, chief priests, and legal experts, and be killed, and then after 3 days rise from the dead. He said this plainly, but Peter took hold of Jesus and, scolding him, began to correct him. Jesus turned and looked at his disciples, then sternly corrected Peter. "Get behind me, Satan. You are not thinking God's thoughts, but human's thoughts." After calling the crowd together with his disciples, Jesus said to them, "All who want to come after me must say no to themselves and take up their cross and follow me. All who want to save their lives will lose them. But all those who lose their lives because of me and because of the good news will save them. Why would people gain the whole world but lose their lives?" Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. We open our hearts to God.
A friend of mine recently wrote this insightful post on Facebook. He shared, "I struggle with Christians, if I'm being honest, who try and put a happy face on all of life issues. Some things are hard in life, and putting on a happy face for others really isn't biblical. Consider these moments in time recorded in the Bible. First, Lazarus died, and Jesus wept. He didn't laugh. Second, Jesus came upon a woman of ill repute. He did not make it a joyous moment. While others wanted to stone her, Jesus knelt and said, 'He who has no sin cast the first stone.' And everyone left. And then when he was alone with her, he had an honest conversation. No laughter. Third, the story of the Samaritan. The Samaritan did not say, 'Get up, be healed, be full of joy.' He knelt beside the fallen man, dressed his wounds, let that sink in, carried him to a safe place, paid for his welfare. Never once did he enjoin the man to rise up and be okay. The Samaritan lived in the moment, in genuine terms. Fourth, when Jacob was alone in the desert, running for his life and complaining, God met him right there. God did not say, 'Turn around, put on a smiley face, and live life.' Nope, God got on the ground and wrestled right there with Jacob all night long. Fifth, Joseph was sold into slavery by his own brothers due to jealousy. Down the road, much time lapsed, and God did not seem bothered by Joseph being in this unfair situation. Let that sink in. And after many years of no justice, Joseph's story changed. Never once did God ask him or encourage him to put a smiley face on. There are many more genuine, authentic stories like this in the Bible, which tells me God is not afraid of hard moments, even hard moments that last a long time. So why are we so quick to try and put a smiley face on this day when maybe God's will is for us to live in this moment the way it was recorded in the Bible, honestly, genuinely? I fully believe there are times we have to live by faith and express joy, even though that is not how we feel, as we are not to be led about by feelings alone. I also believe it is unbiblical to falsely proclaim joy when maybe God wants us to sit in the mess of life, just like he has done many times in the Bibles, and understand that he is with us in everything, good, bad, and indifferent. Maybe I am a heretic. I think not. I am so grateful for Jack's words as we come to this third Sunday in Lent, where our story finds Jesus on the road to the cross and he calls others to join him in his pilgrimage. Lent is a time of self-denial, and Jesus's words are a strong call to that vocation, not as an end in itself or a means to some sort of self-help goal like dieting, but rather as a counter-cultural missional testimony. And that's what my friend was saying. Those who travel this Lenten road aren't first of all focused on Easter, but on Good Friday. They do not presume a glorious outcome that gathers the media like paparazzi vultures, but sense that the journey of service brings light in darkness, hope in despair, healing for pain, and faith where power corrupts and destroys. If that sounds just a bit too heavy, perhaps this is a good time for us to remember that Sundays in Lent do not belong to Lent. They're not Sundays of Lent, the way that Sundays of Advent are owned by that season. When counting the 40 days of Lent of this season, beginning at Ash Wednesday, it becomes clear when you add up all the numbers that the Sundays are not registered in that tally. And because we live in a post-Easter world, the Sundays during Lent are oases of grace in what could otherwise become a horrible time of recrimination without mercy. And while the theme of discipleship must carry us down this path of self-denial, it must never lose sight of grace. Easter grace, divine grace, life-giving grace. And that is why any who would echo Peter's plea for a nicer and more sanitized version of Jesus' biography actually undermine the power of divine favor. Or in the poetic words of Barbara Holmes, joy unspeakable erupts when you least expect it, when the burden is greatest, when the hope is gone after bullets fly. It rises on the crest of impossibility. It sways to the rhythm of steadfast hearts and celebrates what we cannot see. So, here in the Gospel of Mark, we see both a question and a calling. Just who is this Christ we purport to follow? And how do we make sense of him in all the confusing, often conflicting ideas of what his call on our lives really means? And part of the difficulty is that the New Testament doesn't paint this beautiful, uniform portrait of Christ. Not only do we have four very different gospels, each is remarkably unique in their individual understandings of the meaning of Jesus' ministry. And then there are 23 additional books that articulate varying views of Jesus. Even the 13 letters that we attribute to Paul adapt the function and significance of Jesus Christ, depending on the circumstances that need to be addressed in each congregation. And we won't do anyone any favors by pretending that those discrepancies don't exist. That's what my friend was trying to say in his post. There's already too much "the Bible says" out there without adding to the idea that all the writers say the exact same thing. And as one of our tasks in the church is to help all of us be better readers of the Bible, I want to say right here and now, there is no one view of Jesus, and not all writers in the New Testament think, say, or write the exact same thing. Now,
I really understand the enticement of synchronizing the New Testament and the Old Testament, for that matter. At stake in the uniformity of the New Testament is how we define certain truths like salvation, judgment, sin. And if these theological categories lack this longed-for level of consistency, then who is right and who is wrong? Who gets the final say when it comes to interpreting God's activity in the world? Who gets to make the decisions about eternal life? Who do we believe when we do a Google search about a question in the Bible and see this long list of people with a wide discrepancy of understandings? And that's exactly it. You see the confusion? Passing over all those illogicalities is just plain easier. After all, everyone else is doing it. And perhaps we even wonder if we can handle the inconsistencies that to become aware of the breadth of the variety of witnesses about Christ would somehow shatter our faith, pulling out our strategically placed card in the house of cards known as belief. I have a cousin who, when I brought up some of those discrepancies, just looked at me and said, "I can't question that, because if I question one thing, it will all fall apart for me." So this discloses a rather dysfunctional interpretation of the meaning and role of Scripture in our lives, because that implies that the Scripture is the sole authority for theological discernment, when, of course, God was known first outside of anything that was ever written down, more specifically outside of the writings that we have canonized and call our holy Scriptures. Our confirmation class just learned last week about the Wesleyan quadrilateral, where we take Scripture first, but then we also use tradition and reason and experience to make decision about the truth in our lives. So yes, we could and should spend some time thinking about how we should respond to Jesus' question of his identity, considering, if Jesus asked us, "Who do you say that I am?" what our answer might be, because that is always a worthwhile reflection, and it changes as we grow and experience things on our faith journey. But there's even more that Jesus is asking in this seemingly straightforward question, and perhaps it's this more that is the most challenging, the most demanding, the more that we often wish we could avoid. Because "who do you say that I am?" is at the same time, "who will you say that you are?" The question, you see, leads to the calling. And that's the rub of this question, the heart of the difficulty. If it only had to provide an answer to Jesus' question of his identity, that would be one thing. However, answering the question of Jesus' identity is also having to give voice to our own. Who you say Jesus is who you have decided to be. You can't answer Jesus' inquiry without revealing who you are. Or we could switch it around. Who you are reveals who you have decided Jesus to be. You see, Jesus' question, it's not a test. It's not about getting the answer right. It's the moment that you come face to face with your own commitment, your own discipleship, your own identity. It's the moment when you have to actually admit to what extent following Jesus actually connects with some sort of confession of who you believe Jesus to be. And have you noticed that there's often not a lot of correlation these days between claims about Jesus and choices about how lives are actually lived? And whether that be individuals, churches, or institutions of the church. But who do you say that I am is not just an issue of integrity or an evasion of hypocrisy. It's being willing to risk being known for what you believe. It's recognizing that your identity cannot be separated from your understanding of who Jesus is. And Peter has to answer the question, as do every single one of Jesus' disciples, for himself. And so too do we. In the scripture, Peter answers Jesus' questions with the words, "You are the Christ." And he was right. And yet, that answer was so incomplete. And he's not alone in that. All the writers in the New Testament try to answer that question of what that means. For Jesus himself, it meant following him, one who would suffer, die, experience rejection, correct his disciples in their understanding of what that meant. And then he moves to this calling of those who call him Christ, the calling to deny oneself, to take up the cross, to follow him. In the words of our own mission statement, right here at Desert Skies, to live a Christ-like life that serves the world, that engages people where they are, that calls us to share joys and concerns, to walk alongside one another in good times and bad, to smile and to weep together. This past month was Black History Month, and many of us connected in new ways with this part of our American history. So now some of us have some new heroes, people who have struggled with the question and the call, who still are struggling. And oh, it is so important and helpful to continue to look for and share such concrete examples of what Jesus calls us to do in our own histories, in our own backyards, and around the world. For these do give us courage to seek to do the same. So we all have heroes, yes, but they're flawed ones, imperfect ones. Because it goes without saying, of course, that not one of our human heroes will ever fully emulate the fullness of what we are called to now. When Vince Lombardi was hired as head coach of the Green Bay Packers back in 1958, the team was in dismal shape. A single win in season play the year before had socked the club solidly into the basement of the NFL, and sportscasters everywhere used to use it as the butt of loser jokes. But Lombardi picked and pulled and prodded and trained and disciplined the players into becoming a winning team. They were NFL champions in three consecutive seasons and took the game honors for the first two Super Bowls. Lombardi was a drill sergeant and a strategist, finding and developing the best in each of his players individually, and then crafting a team community that could visualize the prize. "Winning isn't everything," he's often quoted as saying. "It's the only thing." And his Packers proved him true over and over again. In our text today, there's a new team being called into existence by a great leader. Jesus, when facing his own demise, calls to the crowds to join him in the greatest endeavor ever attempted on planet Earth, the overthrow of the powers and principalities of the world. So who do you say that Jesus is? Are you ready to play on his team? Because he's going to ask you, who then are you? And let all of God's people say, amen.
Hello, I'm Ken Winkleman, one of your lay leaders here at Desert Skies. Today we've been called to listen to the words of wisdom and to respond with our whole lives. Let us give thanks to God with all that we are and all that we have, in word, thought, and action. This is the time of the service that we generally give out of our abundance, which we have been blessed. We ask you to prepare your offering check and mail it to the church at 3255 North Houghton Road, Tucson, Arizona, 85749, or go online to www.desertskiesumc.org and click on the donate button. Thank you.
And now, Christ our Lord invites all to his table who love him and who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Will you join me in the prayer of confession? Lord, it is easy for us to say that we will follow you and then turn our backs and act as though a commitment to you does not mean anything to us. Jesus challenges us to take up our crosses, and when we don't understand what that means, we just shrug and turn away. Forgive us for our lack of commitment and faith. Heal us of our greed and fears. Give us courage to be disciples and enable us to joyfully proclaim your healing mercies and your transformational love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Receive the healing love of Jesus. Give your lives to his service through service and care to one another. Be at peace. Amen. God of mercy and of hope, be with us this day. We've gathered here to learn of your will for us. Sometimes it's not easy for us to realize that if we're to follow Jesus, we'll have to make a total commitment to his ways. We'll have to actually put into practice the good news of compassionate love and healing mercies. Our hearts are filled with concerning situations of our families and friends, neighbors and neighborhoods and the world. We seek your healing mercies for these situations and loved ones. Help us to remember that the same healing mercy is offered to each one of us. Give us strength and courage to really follow Jesus, for it is in his name we pray. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right, and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. You brought all things into being and called them good. From the dust of the earth, you formed us into your image and breathed into us the breath of life. And when we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. When rain fell upon the earth for 40 days and 40 nights, you bore up the ark on the waters, saved Noah and his family, and made covenant with every living creature on earth. When you led your people to Mount Sinai for 40 days and 40 nights, you gave us your commandments and made us your covenant people. And when your people forsook your covenant, your prophet Elijah fasted for 40 days and 40 nights, and on your holy mountain, he heard your still small voice. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, 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 holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. When you gave him to save us from our sin, your Spirit led him into the wilderness, where he fasted 40 days and 40 nights to prepare for his ministry. When he suffered and died on a cross for our sin, you raised him to life, presented him alive to the apostles during 40 days, and exalted him at your right hand. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. And now, when we, your people, prepare for the yearly feast of Easter, you lead us to repentance for sin and the cleansing of our hearts, that during these 40 days of Lent, we may be gifted and graced to reaffirm the covenant you made with us through Christ. On the night Jesus gave himself up for us, he took the bread, gave thanks to you. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
And when the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you, for this is the cup of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died.
Christ is risen.
Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on all of us gathered here and online around the world, and on these gifts of bread and cup. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood.
By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. And now, with the confidence of children of God, we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Though we are not all gathered physically in one place, we are united as one through the Spirit as we feast on these gifts of life. If you'll be coming for drive-through communion, we will be prepared to serve you at 11 o'clock at each of our campuses. If you are coming for in-person worship at 10 o'clock, we also have those elements prepared for you at that time. And if you're celebrating communion with us at home, you're invited to take whatever you have brought before you to eat and to drink. Take what you've brought to eat and lift it, giving thanks, and eat of it. For this is the body of Christ given for you. And take whatever you have brought and lift it and drink it. For it is the cup, the sacrifice of God's love for you. Drink it with thanksgiving.
God, we hear and we respond to your words of wisdom, your words of call and life. May these gifts, not only of our money, but of bread and cup and our very selves, our words, our thoughts, our actions, be acceptable to you and help spread your words of life and love. Amen.
As we continue on the journey of discovering who Christ is for us, the identity that we claim, as his followers, we have opportunities in this church to discover with the body of Christ that's on that same journey. And so we have Christ Cafe immediately following our online services where you can Zoom chat with fellow travelers on the journey. We have a Facebook page that's a way to engage and to share and to read reflections such as my friend shared with me on our Desert Skies pages, on our Read Through the Bible page, as we discover things and want to share them with each other. Our website is a fount of information, and our connection card lets you list your prayer requests and your presence to us so that we can celebrate that you are on the journey with us. And so we encourage you to use all of those tools of connection and of learning and of growing and of bouncing ideas off of each other. We rejoice to know that our choir is preparing a cantata for Palm Sunday. They will be filming that. It will be recorded live, and you'll be able to enjoy that. So keep our choir in prayer as they learn new technology and sing together for the first time in a long time, albeit with safety protocols in place. And now receive the benediction. Go in peace and know that God walks with you on your journey and bring the good news of God's healing love to everyone you meet. Amen.